Do you feel the energy in this room, in the sanctuary, as we all connect with one another? Do you feel God in this space connecting us? If you're online, do you feel God connecting you to all those who are a part of the body of Christ, even if you are far away from them? God is with us, connecting us with one another every step of the way. And I am so glad that we get to be a part of that. I'm so glad that we get to be here together, connecting and growing so that we can be sent out into the world to serve as Jesus followers, a community of Jesus followers. My name is Carissa Miller, and I am the associate pastor here at Topeka First United Methodist Church. And it is a joy to be in worship with you all this morning. We have a good God, and this time of the year gets really exciting with all the different transitions that are going on with graduations and all those life changes that come with that, the bittersweetness of endings and new beginnings. And in this space, we get to celebrate those and grieve those. It's also Mother's Day today, and so that brings with it both joy and grief for many of us, and a whole host of other emotions. So we thank God for being with us in all of it, and for allowing us to lay it all down at God's feet. As you were coming in today, you were handed a connection card by our ushers, and so I would encourage you to take a moment to fill that out, and you can put that in the offering plates that are here on the front area, on the pews, as you leave the sanctuary, and there's also a place online to do it. And then on the back of that card, there's a place for prayer requests. And so I'd encourage you to also write any joys or concerns that you would like to share with the congregation or with our prayer team or our pastors. And we would love to pray with you for those things. Let us take a deep breath and center ourselves as we enter into this time of being filled up by God's Spirit, so that we may go into the world and bring God's light and love wherever we go. Now I encourage you to greet one another, to continue that energy that was bubbling in the room before the service started in Christian love. To break the party up, you can stay wherever you're at and just plant yourself there or next to a new friend if you want. Let us listen for God speaking in this prelude.
Thank you.
Thank you, Don. That was beautiful. It's called Blessing and Honor. Blessing and Honor to our God. Now I invite you to stand in body or spirit for our call to worship. The words should be on the screen. And this call to worship is based on the 23rd Psalm, one that many of us know and love. We rejoice in the one who leads us beside still waters. Christ, our shepherd, shows us the way we should go. Though all manner of evil befall us, we will not be afraid. We are never away from the love and mercy of the Lord. Amen.
Our opening hymn today is number 88, Maker in Whom We Live.
So today we have the opportunity to celebrate our graduates, those from high school and college and from vocational schools and tech schools. It's an exciting time to celebrate the way that God has moved in these individuals' lives and brought them to this place, helped them to get through all the trials of writing papers and taking tests and has brought them to this place where now they get to celebrate that and take the next step into the next chapter of their lives. So I'm going to read the names of our graduates, and I encourage them, if they are here, to stand so that we can recognize them, and then we're going to say a prayer for them. From high school, we have Adrian Cox, who's graduating from Washburn Rural, Trinidad Garcia, who's graduating from Silver Lake, Noah Haskins, graduating from Washburn Rural, Carter Seth, who's graduating from Linden, and Gage Williams, who's graduating from Seaman. And then from college and vocational tech, we have William Nager from Washburn Law School, Cooper Self from Creighton Law School, Erica Self has Emporia State University, Eric Guzman from ESU, Ethan Guzman from Allen County, and Jessica Morris Garlinghouse from USC. So let's give all these folks a hand, a round of applause. You guys may be seated if you want. I don't want to make you continue standing. And I was talking with Mary up here a bit ago, and she said, I remember when some of them were babies, and when they were born. And it makes me just think about those promises that we make at baptism to nurture and to raise up those in our congregation. And we have done that. So let us pray. Oh God, in whom we move and breathe and live and have our being, we thank you today for all the ways that you've moved in these students' lives, for the strength you've given them to get through the hardest times, for the guidance you've given them to take these paths that they have taken. Lord, we thank you that they have finished their courses and that they are ready to take the next step, and we pray that you would bless them in that. Help them to say goodbye and also to start anew. Comfort them in whatever ways they grieve the past, and delight in them as they discover new possibilities. We pray that you would give them guidance and wisdom on the path forward and what to do next, and that you would give them peace and knowing that they don't have to have it all figured out, but just take the next right step, the next step in following you and your will. We pray you would protect them and keep them, and that they would feel your presence and your love every single day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Good morning. Graduates, congratulations. It's been a long journey, right? All the way from kindergarten on up through now. Next step is going to be amazing. My name is Mary Beck, and would you please stay seated for our affirmation of faith? We're going to be saying the Apostles' Creed, so if you would please join with me. It's going to be presented up on the screen. If you have it memorized, even better. You get 2 extra credit points for that, graduates. Those of you who have graduated a long time ago, you still get your 2 extra credit points. So if you would join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The 3rd day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father. Oh.
reading this morning today is the 23rd Psalm. And if you're familiar with it, obviously we've already kind of talked about it this morning. It's the one that says, "The Lord is my shepherd." And if you look right over there, we have this beautiful stained glass showing this beautiful pastoral rendition of Jesus holding sheep. But I want to give you a different view. I was a 4-H kid, and my brother and I, for a few years, decided to do Market Land Project. And we 1 year bought four lambs. And we got them all from one farm, and we loaded them up in our vehicle, which is a whole nother story. Sorry, Mom and Dad, for that moment. We brought them home, and in the process of unloading them, they looked like that. They were cute, very cute. They managed, though, in that moment to escape from the vehicle and the pen and us. And my brother and I stood there looking at each other in horror, slightly, because we had just lost our projects to the woods. We were angry because we had just lost our projects. We were upset. And we were also scared for those little lambs because they didn't know us. We have coyotes. Who knows what's going to happen? So you can't call a sheep like a dog, just so you know. And especially ones that don't know your name, your voice at all. So we did manage to catch one out of the four. And we put it in the pen, and we searched and searched and searched, and eventually two of them came out of the woods, thankfully. But one stayed on his little field trip, and we searched for days. And finally, in desperation, we took one of them out, and it started bleeding because it wanted to be back with the other two. And we thought, well, maybe it will call it in. No, no, no. And then one day I went across the road, and the lady said, "Well, I saw them with my horses." Sheep aren't supposed to be with horses. They're supposed to be with other sheep. And we finally got that one to come home by taking another one out. And, you know, I think taking a look back now, there's a lesson there that, you know, we're kind of like sheep. Taking care of sheep isn't easy, even though it looks like it there in the wind. We don't always do what God wants us to do, and many times we don't know his voice, just like those sheep didn't know our voice. And so today, as you hear this scripture, maybe you can think about the idea that we're not always listening for the ultimate shepherd's voice, and we stray off into the woods of our busy lives and the other distractions, and even we go to places where we shouldn't be. But how lucky are we that God provides the voices of other sheeples from our church family to shepherd us back home, back to safety, back to God's loving care, and back to what we need, back to what our souls need. And how blessed is it that we are called to also be the sheep taken out by the good shepherd into the world to find the lost, using our voices and our presence and our experience to bring them home to what we all need, which is the love of God and Jesus. So the 23rd Psalm, a Psalm of David. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long." Amen.
Turn to page 496, and we'll sing the first verse of Sweet Hour of Prayer.
In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and oft escaped the tempter's snare. By thy return, sweet hour of prayer.
Would you please take a moment to offer up your personal prayer to God? And then after a few moments of time, I'll lead us in a congregational prayer. Loving God, thank you today for graduates and the families who have supported them through this journey. We thank you for mothers and children and for all the joy of family life. Today be with those that are grieving because they may not have a mother. Be close to those who are struggling because they might not have children. Be near to those who are sad because they are far apart from those they love. God, help us to remember that the people of your church are also a big part of that family life, and they need our love, care, and support too. Let your love be present in every home, and help your church to have eyes to see and ears to hear the needs of all who come and those who've yet to come. Help us to go out into the world and be the ones whom God uses to guide others to a shepherding voice, to lead others to the green pastures and still waters to restore their souls. Just like a lost lamb, we know that there are many searching for him but don't know his voice. Lord, we want to be your voice for them. Let us prepare our hearts and voices by saying the prayer today that Jesus taught his disciples so very long ago. Our Father, art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you to turn to page 452 in your hymnal for our hymn of century, number 452, My Faith Looks Up to Thee.
Hear me while I pray.
In responding to God's continuous movement and speaking in our lives, we now take time to discern how God is calling us to give from all that we have been given. By giving from what we've been given, we join him and partner with God, thus making God's movement in the world more visible and clear to others. We help people notice God, because in many ways we are using our gifts to put flesh onto God's love in our current setting, much like Jesus did when he walked the earth. As you discern what God is calling you to give, you can prepare to drop offerings and commitment cards in the plates when you exit. Or you can plan to give online at our website or by texting SHARE to the number 73256. If you feel God calling you to give your time, resources, or talents in a new way, please let me, Caressa, Jeff, or any other leader in the church know.
During this time of offering, let us rejoice as we have this opportunity to give back to God. Hymn number 160, Rejoice Ye Pure in Heart.
Bow your heads with me and pray. Eternal God, we present our tithes and offering to you now as a token of our love for you. We know that our financial giving is not the only thing you require. We remember your mandate to take your gospel to the whole world. We remember that you desire us to love you with all our hearts, our minds, and our souls. And remember that you told us to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Lord, please help us to measure up in our love and service. Amen. Our next scripture reading comes from Acts It's the 9th chapter, verses 36 through 43. Sorry, I don't have a story for this one. Now in Joppa, there was a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. At that time, she became ill and died. And when they had washed her, they had laid her in her room upstairs. And since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, who heard that Peter was there, sent two men to him with the request, "Please come to us without delay." So Peter got up and went with them. And when he arrived, they took him to the room upstairs. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Peter put all of them outside, and then he knelt down and prayed. He turned to the body and said, "Tabitha, get up." Then she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he showed her to be alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Meanwhile, he stayed in Joppa for some time with a certain Simon, a tanner. And our final scripture is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. May the word of God be for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, choir, for that anthem. Thank you all for your presence this morning. It is such a joy to be with you as we come into this time of worship today. My name is Jeff Klinger, lead pastor, and again, what a privilege on this day when we celebrate graduates and when we name the reality that it's Mother's Day, and that's joyful and wonderful and challenging and hard for different people in different measure, that we come together and spend this hour thinking about, reflecting about, praying about, and then practicing and living into what does it mean for us to be the church together? There is this fascinating thing that has happened over the last couple of years where for a season, this space was empty on Sunday mornings, right? You were out there. I always trusted and always believed that there were voices on the other side. And I knew that in part because whenever there were technical problems, you'd let us know that there were technical problems, right? But I have these vivid memories of a couple of Sundays early in the pandemic when I would look out into the sanctuary here and it would be like my kids and a weird cardboard cutout that I had that I'd placed out there just to pretend like there were more people that were here, you know. What does it mean to be the church together? And so we're walking through this series right now, looking at some of these great stories from the book of Acts and those ways in which the very earliest followers of Jesus were trying to figure that out, and then fast forwarding these 2,000 years to where we are today and looking at how is it that we live, taking those lessons, building upon those lessons, and making them realities for our lives and for others to whom we are connected today. And so as I begin our time together this morning, I found myself this week really reflecting on a handful of things. And it's one of those weeks where there was a lot more sermon written than there will be preached, right? Because I'm smart enough to like do all my homework and not preach all my homework, right? So if you want to ask me later, I can tell you about the Disney connection and tie-ins that didn't make it into this week's sermon after having been in Disney World a week prior, right? And I'll be happy to talk a little bit about like the Mother's Day theme and the Mother's Day tie-in that I ended up leaving out of the conversation. But begin this morning thinking about a season in my life. I'm probably about 4 or 5 years old, and my family is selling one house and buying another house. And in the midst of that transition, my sister and I are tagging along quite a bit with my mom, and I find myself totally enamored with our real estate lady. Right, she was incredible. And she was everything that you would expect a real estate lady to need to be to do that work well, right? Like there was the loving and the generous and the kind and the caring and the compassionate for us because, you know, she was representing us. And then she had this power that just mesmerized me, right? Like we could just tell her a house that we wanted to go see and she had the power to get us into that house whenever we wanted to get into that house. And I thought it was fantastic. And so I watched the way that our real estate lady lived and I watched the things that our real estate lady did. And I came to the only natural conclusion for a young man at the age of 4 or 5 to make. I was able to clearly say, when I grow up, I want to be a real estate lady. Right? The only logical conclusion in the midst of that. Because when we see somebody who lives in a way that we want to live, or who does the things that we want to do, when there's a person that captures our attention and our imagination, we can't help but want to be like that person. They say, of course, that imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, but I imagine if you spent a moment reflecting back through your life, especially in those formative years, you could name somebody who lived in such a way and who impacted you in such a way that you thought to yourself, I want to be like them when I grow up. So here we are again, continuing this conversation about how is it that we, 2,000 years later, live as the church, as individual followers of Jesus who come together in community with one another to be the church in the world. And as we walk through that conversation this morning, the foundation for the conversation is this idea that we are called to be imitators of Christ. We'll come back to that in a variety of different ways. Now, one of the words that we use all the time and don't hardly think anything about is a word that was used to describe some of those very first followers of Jesus, but a word that has fascinating implications and imagery. And the word's Christian, and again, we don't think anything of it, right? You can travel around Topeka today and there's a Christian bookstore here and a Christian coffee shop here, and you can buy Christian literature and you can watch Christian movies, and it's become this descriptor for so many different things. But at its very beginning, the word Christian isn't used as a descriptor in that sense. It's used as a noun to describe a group of people and to describe the way that they are functioning in the world. And I recently heard Lynn Sweet, who's an author and a theologian, talk about that word, and it captured my attention. He helped us to understand that the word we translate as Christian in English is the Greek word Christianos, and it's a compound word that consists of two parts. The first is Christ, a word that's familiar to us, and then the other is a word tien, that we don't necessarily use that much. And Christ is the word that means anointed one or Messiah, and tien is the diminutive, which means little. And so the idea is that if we are calling ourselves Christians, that is the idea that we would be little Christs in the world, right? That we would run around looking like Christ, living like Christ, acting like Christ, and that people who see us would think, oh, look, there go those little Jesuses. There go those little Christs, right? Engaging the world around us. And as Sweet talked about this, he pointed towards C.S. Lewis's great work, Mere Christianity. And there's a great quotation there where Lewis lifts up this idea of our invitation to be little Christs. He says this, "Now the whole offer which Christianity makes is this, that we can, if we let God have God's way, we can come to share in the life of Christ. Every Christian is to become a little Christ. The whole purpose of becoming a Christian is simply nothing else. The whole purpose of becoming a Christian is to be a little Christ. And as we seek to follow Jesus, as we seek to live as little Christs in the world, we are invited to pattern our engagement with other people and our engagement with God after the way in which Christ engaged God and engaged other people. As we think about what it is to live as little Christs, the invitation is that we would be imitators of Christ. And again, on some level, this might seem obvious and it seems simple, but what I see in the church today is that there's been this profound shift where things are very different than a whole bunch of people who walk into a space or who gather online each week and ask themselves the question, how can I best be a little Christ, right? I mean, I would imagine that few of us came into this time this morning thinking, I'm here to figure out how I can best be a little Christ. And instead, what I have found over the last several generations is that the church has come to be engaged in very similar ways to restaurants or to entertainment that you might go to, whether that's a movie or a theater production somewhere. Think about the way that you engage those things, right? Somebody tells you about a new restaurant, you have to try it. You go, you try the restaurant, and you walk away from the restaurant asking yourself versions of these questions. How did they do to meet my needs? How did that live up to my expectations? Was that prepared to my liking? Am I satisfied with what I received there? Similarly, if you go see the latest and greatest movie, you walk away with that same sense of kind of question and conversation, right? Did it live up to the hype? How was the script written? How was the acting executed? How was the production put together? How do I like or not like that which I just consumed? And over the last generations or so, the church in many ways has become a consumable that people engage in much the same way. And they step into the space on Sunday mornings, and then they depart, and they have a conversation about how did that meet my preferences or my needs? How was that prepared to my satisfaction or my liking? But as we seek to live as little Christs in the world, the invitation is that we would live as imitators of Christ, not simply consumers of religious goods and services prepared to our liking. Which brings us again back to the story of Tabitha and Peter. that we read in the book of Acts. And really, this is two stories that come together to be one story. And I want to lift up each of their stories individually because Tabitha is living and engaging the world in a certain way, and Peter is living and engaging the world in a certain way. And when their stories intersect with each other, again, we see an image of what it is to be a little Christ living in the world. So if you've got your Bible with you, I would invite you to open up this morning. Where'd mine go? There it is. I'm totally thrown off by not being out here and preaching, but I've got this head cold such that if I'm out there and preaching, I'll have no idea what I'm doing this morning, right? So though I lost my Bible momentarily, it's helpful to have my notes here in front of me. Last Sunday, Pastor Carissa preached from this very same chapter, Acts 9, that story of Saul becoming Paul and the transformation that happens there. And so if you've got your Bible, I hope you see some note or some reference to that marked up from last Sunday. This is a different story about different people, but it's that continuation of the way that that story unfolds. And if you begin in verse 36, where Mary began reading for us today, we're introduced to the person of Tabitha. Now in Joppa, there was a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. That's it for Tabitha. That's it to be a disciple in that very first conversation around seeking to follow Jesus. Devoted to good works and to acts of charity. And why is Tabitha living in this way? It's because she's pursuing this idea of being an imitator of Christ. She is still living amongst and walking with people who knew Jesus during his life and his ministry. And so the idea is that if we're going to follow Jesus, if we're going to be this community who's following Jesus, even though he has died and risen from the dead and ascended into heaven, we're modeling our lives after him. Good works, acts of charity. And as we continue to read Tabitha's story through there, we read that she soon dies and is laid to rest. And in the midst of that time, the community is grieving in a variety of ways. And so some of the disciples who are there with her understand that Peter's really not that far away. He's just in a neighboring community. And so they call out to Peter, please come and be with us. Do not delay. And Peter does, which brings Peter's story into this story, right? Peter had been traveling, had things that he was doing, was interrupted in the midst of that and called to come. And Peter steps into the room where Tabitha is laid, excuses those persons who are there and filling the room with their grief and with their concerns about how Tabitha had done different things. We're told that Peter kneels down and spends time in prayer. And then almost as if in the midst of that time of prayer, he turns to Tabitha and says, Tabitha, get up. And she does. And there is, in that moment, this great connection to the story of Jesus who raises Lazarus from the dead, who's called to come back from a neighboring community, who's interrupted in the midst of what he's been doing, and who steps into that place and brings Lazarus back to new life. Tabitha also experiences new life. So both in Tabitha and in Peter, there are invitations for us about what it looks like to be imitators of Christ. For Tabitha, it's the way in which she's living and the rhythms that she's got, right? She's doing these good works. She's doing these acts of charity. And for Peter, the invitation is not likely that any of us will raise somebody from the dead, but the invitation is that when we are called by God to come and to bring healing into the midst of people who have need, we will not make excuses and we will not delay, but we will respond to God's invitation and to be present for that work and for the healing that comes. Again, both Tabitha and Peter offer for us an image of what it is to be little Christs, to be imitators of Christ. And so the idea is that we are to be imitators of Christ over the course of the last 2,000 years leading us to today. That's what the church has been, people in relationship with God and with one another trying to figure out how to be imitators of Christ. But as I have alluded to already, it seems like in some way through the generations, a misalignment of sorts has happened, right? There is kind of the consumeristic posture that we've talked about already, but there are a whole variety of kind of stereotypes that exist about the church today. And maybe you've heard them, right? If you try to invite your kids or your grandkids or your friends from work to come to church, you know, come to church with me on Sunday. Maybe it's Easter, it's Palm Sunday, and they likely say to you things like, no thanks. I don't want to have anything to do with the church. They're too judgmental, critical, hypocritical, rigid, self-righteous. You know, you can think of all those kinds of things that the church is often called today. And my fear is that all of this comes from those of us who are following Jesus, not being imitators of Christ as much as we are being imitators of imitators, right? Imitators, imitating, imitators, imitating, imitators. Think about the game Telephone. Anybody remember playing that? I was tempted to have you play it this morning, right? But we're not going to take the time to do that. You might remember that game, right? You're sitting in a circle, elementary-aged kids, teachers and parents, or scout leaders, or Sunday school teachers, whatever that is in the circle. And somebody's the leader, and they start, and they're supposed to say like one word or one simple phrase, and they don't say it out loud, but they whisper it in the ear of the person next to them. And then as silently as is possible, they turn and they whisper that in the ear of the person next to them. And then as silently as is possible, it works its way around the room until it comes back to the last person. And they're supposed to say out loud to the room the message that the first person said. Have you done this recently, right? Or at least you remember doing this in the past? Has anybody ever sat in one of those circles when the correct thing came out of the last person's mouth? I don't think I have, right? Sometimes it's like, oh, close, but just off a little bit. Sometimes it has nothing to do with what was said in the first place. And my fear is that over the last 2,000 years, the church has been doing this to Jesus, right? Like Jesus said something and somebody was an imitator of Christ for a while, but then the imitation of the imitation of the imitation of the imitation got distorted to the point where the church has this reputation of being self-righteous and hypocritical and judgmental, and all of that has nothing to do with the love and the grace and the mercy that was the core of Jesus' life and ministry. And so what does it mean for us to follow Christ, to imitate Christ? What exactly is it that we're called to be imitators of? Now, I would hope that it's obvious. We are not, I don't believe, any of us called to be first century Jewish rabbis, right? Like, we don't live in the first century. We don't live in the area that is now understood to be Israel. We live here in Middle America in the 21st century. And so when we think about what it is to be imitators of Christ, at some level we were handed this helpful question from the cloth bracelets of the 1990s, right? WWJD, what would Jesus do? Brought to us even before that from work even of a Topeka pastor. And as helpful as that question has been for some, even it misses the mark to a degree, right? Because if we ask ourselves the question, what would Jesus do? There are times when the only honest answer is we have no idea, right? Like, I am a variety of things right now in life. One of those is the parent of a teenager trying to figure out how do you parent a teenager in the digital age, right? Now, I can read the Bible from cover to cover and find zero instances of Jesus parenting a teenager in the digital age, right? So what would Jesus do is not a question that helps respond in that. But Dallas Willard, who is one of the great leaders in the last century of spiritual formation conversations, Dallas Willard expands the conversation in a slightly different way and invites us to think about it like this. He says, Dallas Willard, I am learning from Jesus to live my life as he would live my life if he were I. I am not necessarily learning to do everything he did, but I am learning how to do everything I do in the manner that he did, all that he did. Do you get the distinction here? How would Jesus live your life if he were you? At work tomorrow? At home with your kids tomorrow night? Dealing with frustrating things in the community throughout the course of this week? It might be that what would Jesus do doesn't bring you a clear and an obvious answer, but as one who is invited to be a little Christ, to be an imitator of Christ, the question is there for your consideration. How would Jesus live your life if he were you? All right, as we move to a close this morning, As I continue to think about that great overarching question, what does it mean for us to be the church together in this season? I continue to be so excited about the potential that exists here for Topeka First United Methodist Church. Twice this week, even, I took a meeting that I had for a walk because it was such a beautiful week, and both times we walked the same route. We got right here to the corner of 6th and Harrison, and then we headed east toward Kansas Avenue, and we came south then on Kansas Avenue to 10th and across in front of the Capitol building. And we didn't go quite as far as Topeka High, though you can go that far west if you want, walking that loop, and then north back through that neighborhood to 6th Street before back to the church. And when you walk that simple loop, drive it when you leave here today if you want, right? When you walk or drive that simple loop, you encounter an incredible diversity of the Topeka community. Like the millions of dollars that has been dumped in private and public development into downtown and the Kansas Avenue corridor shows us one part of our city, and to the west of us, another part of our city. And in both of those parts of our city, there is great need, and people who are struggling, and people who are hurting, and people who need to experience the reality of Christ in their lives. And we are invited to be imitators of Christ in the world around us. And so again, I think about Tabitha, and I think about Peter. I think about what it is to be imitators of Christ, who do those works of love and care and justice, what it is to be imitators of Christ, who hear God's call and interrupt what we're doing and go to those places of need to bring healing. And my hope and my prayer for each of us is that we would continue to live as imitators of Christ, that we would continue to live as little Christs, that we would continue to find those opportunities in the midst of all of those places that we work and live and play to share Christ's love, to live sacrificially, to invite others to know the love that God has for them because of how we are living as imitators of Christ. Would you pray with me? God, we are grateful. Grateful for the way in which you are working in our lives and in the world. We are hopeful, God, for all of the opportunities that exist before us as we continue thinking about who you're calling us to be into the future. And God, as we continue reflecting on your call and how it is so very different than it was 2,000 years ago, but at the same time so similar as to what it was 2,000 years ago, we pray that you would help us to increasingly live as little Christs in the world. Help us to be shaped and formed by your love. Help us to receive the best of those mentors who have come before us and point us toward you, but help us to avoid that trap of becoming imitators of imitators who unintentionally distort the good news of your great love. And help us turn back to you at the beginning of every day that we might live your love for the world around us. God, we're grateful and we're hopeful, and we pray all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
As we look to the great model of our lives and we celebrate that, am I early?
You are.
I'm early.
That's okay. I didn't know what you were doing. I thought maybe, you know.
I was ready.
You were ready. We're going to receive some new members before we close the day out.
That's yeah.
Is this mic pack not working, Dave? Do you all hear me? I get yes from this crowd and no from that crowd. That was the hearing test. Thank you. You all passed? There you go. Now I think we're good. We're going to receive some new members this morning because it's such an exciting time that folks have said, you know what? We're still all figuring out together how to live as the body and as the church, but we want to do that with you and we want to figure that out with you. So if you're intending to join this morning, I want to invite you to come forward and join me here on this first step. I know that it's daunting to step up onto the marble, but we won't go all the way to the top, but if you'd come and join me across the front here. I joke on one level that membership in the church is really answering two different questions. One is, so you want to follow Jesus? And if you say yes to that, that's a good start, right? And then the extension of that is, and you want to do that with these folks, right? At this place, at this time. And if the answer to that is yes, then you're ready to be membered with the body. Sandra, if you'd step up and join me. I know it's one more like place of vulnerability in front of everybody, but they can see you better if you're up there. So we have some more folks who have walked that journey and said, we want to be a part of this body. We want to be connected in this place. We want to be living out what it is that Jesus is calling us to do in relationship with others that are before us there. And so down here on my farthest left are David and Liz Cox. Dave, David, Liz, Elizabeth. They tell me that you can call them any of those things, and that's very fine. David and Elizabeth Cox, long-time involvement with a variety of different churches, but coming to join with us today. And then Beth and Mike Esau. And Beth will also claim these others next to her. Larry and Sandra Budeman are Beth's parents. And so these four transfer from Highland Park United Methodist Church to join our community of faith today. But I'm going to walk you through the slightly more formal questions than, do you really want to follow Jesus and do it with these people? And these questions are really about the three levels that we do church, being a part of the church universal, all believers, all places, all times. Being a part of the United Methodist Church, this global body of believers, and then this local congregation, making this place home. So again, you'll have an opportunity as the body gathered to respond as well, and we'll prompt you when it's time for you to lift your voice. I present these persons before you for your love and your care, and on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness? Do you reject the evil powers of this world and repent of your sin? If so, would you say, I do? Do you accept the freedom and the power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, would you say, I do? And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages and nations and races? If so, would you say, I do? And then according to the grace that's been given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? If so, would you say, I will? And then for you, the body gathered together, do you as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, would you say, we do? And will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons now before you in your care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. So that's about the big church, universal, and what it is to be a follower of Jesus. But as members of Christ's universal church, I ask you, will you be loyal to Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, would you say, I will? And as members then of this congregation, Topeka First United Methodist Church, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, would you say, I will? Members of the household of God, I commend these newest members to you, to your love, to your care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, to confirm their hope, and to perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Welcome, friends. It's been such a joy. I'm grateful that you're here. Would you join me in welcoming them and expressing your gratitude? Thank you. David, thank you. Guys, can return to your seats. Thank you so much.
Go. Boy, what a joy to have new folks coming. I just need to remind you, choir rehearsal is 7 o'clock on Thursday night, and would love to have you. Love to have you. As we sing our last hymn, I invite you to stand for 154. This hymn was written, the words were written 250 years ago by a close friend of Charles Wesley and set by an American tune writer 230 years ago. These words live today as the great model of our lives. This is All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, hymn number 154.
Great day to celebrate together God's love for us all, for all of creation and humanity. What a great day to celebrate graduates and the great role that moms play in our lives. I'm so grateful for all of you as we gather together and spend this time. And now we get to go back into the world and to live as those little imitators of Christ, Christ's representatives and hands and feet in the world. And so a couple of quick invitations before I send you out. First of all, tomorrow evening, that's the 9th of May, 7 p.m., is this year's Nehemiah Action Assembly. We are a partner congregation with Topeka Jump. That's going to be held this year at Lee Arena at Washburn University. It's at 7 o'clock. I think I shared in my e-note Friday that you could begin checking in and registration as early as 6:30. I was way wrong. You can get there as early as 5:45 if you want. I bet if you get there at 6:30, you'll still be okay, but don't show up right at 7. The event begins right at 7 o'clock. It is one of my favorite times every year to gather together with religious leaders in the community of Topeka and to speak together with hope of change for a better community. It is the place every year I feel like I see the most diverse representation of Topeka, racial, ethnically, and socioeconomically both. And so if you've never been, I would invite you to consider showing up tomorrow evening, 7 o'clock, Lee Arena. Our goal is 100 people from our congregation this year, and so we need you to be present for that gathering. Next Sunday, then, the celebrations continue. We're going to welcome new members again, this time through the process of confirmation. Young people who have been walking through that process now over the last semester will have the opportunity to help lead worship and to stand up and to say, I want to follow Jesus, and I want to do this with these people. I'm not just here because mom and dad have been historically dragging me along, right? So it'll be a great day to gather together and to celebrate as the church family. We're doing one combined worship celebration again, right up y'all's alley, 10:45 here in the sanctuary. So if you normally worship at 10:45 in the sanctuary, you are in the right spot. If you normally worship at 8:15 or at 10:30, you'll want to make sure to shift your plans and be here next Sunday for that confirmation celebration, 10:45. In the sanctuary. As we go from this time and back into the world today, though, The hope would be that each of you understand maybe just a little bit more than you did before we stepped into this time together today. That God has created you and loves you unconditionally. That God has gifted you and called you to use those gifts for the sake of the world. And so go from this time today and engage all who you meet in the coming days and weeks as a little Christ, seeking to be an imitator, sharing Christ's love with the world around you. May you live your lives in such a way that all who see you might just want to know your God. Go in peace. Amen.